Dear students, my name is Nidhi Singh. I am from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Hyderabad. In this module, I will be discussing about various nutritional assessment methods. The nutritional status of an individual is often the result of many interrelated factors. It is influenced by food intake, quantity and quality, and physical health. The spectrum of nutritional status spreads from obesity to severe malnutrition. Intake of a diet sufficient to meet or exceed the needs of an individual will keep the composition and function of the otherwise healthy individuals within the normal range. This equilibrium is disturbed by three processes: decreased intake, increased requirements, and altered utilization. When this disequilibrium occurs, the loss of body tissue ensues. However, lack of nutrients produces a series of metabolic changes in relation to energy and protein metabolism within hours or days of reducing nutrients intake, long before demonstrable anthropometric changes. Thus, malnutrition and its adverse consequences depend upon altered intake, functional changes, and finally, anthropometric effects. Nutritional assessment is the interpretation of anthropometric, biochemical, clinical, and dietary data to determine whether a person or groups of people are well nourished or malnourished, overnourished or undernourished. Assessment of nutritional status based on body composition involves detecting the loss or gain of body components relative to previous measurements and relating the values in a given patient to normal standards. The former is affected by the reproducibility and error in the measurement themselves, and the latter is dependent on the normal range of values. A person who starts off at the upper end of the normal range may be classified as normal despite considerable changes in the measured value. Therefore, it is possible for a person to be in a negative nutritional state for a long time before anthropometric measurements fall below normal. The purpose of nutritional assessment is to identify individual or population groups at risk of becoming malnourished, identify individual or population groups who are malnourished, to develop healthcare programs that meet the community needs which are defined by the assessment, and finally, to measure the effectiveness of the nutritional programs and intervention once initiated. Methods of nutritional assessment. Nutrition is assessed by two types of methods, direct and indirect. The direct method deals with the individual and measure objective criteria, while the indirect methods use community health indices that reflect nutritional influences. Direct methods, these may be summarized as A, B, C, D. This stands for A, anthropometric methods, B for biochemical laboratory methods, C for clinical methods, and D for dietary evaluation methods. Anthropometric methods, the word anthropometry comes from two words: anthropo meaning human and metry meaning measurement. In your community, you will be able to use anthropometric measurements to assess either growth or change in the body composition of the people you are responsible for. It is an essential component of clinical examination of infants, children, and pregnant women. Anthropometric measurements including height, weight, skin fold thickness, and circumference, etc., could detect the change of body composition to assess the nutritional status in specific population groups, including newborn, children under the age of 5, and adults. The advantages of using anthropometric measurement is that they can suggest patterns of growth and development of an individual if done regularly. Biochemical laboratory methods. Biochemical assessment deals with measuring the level of essential dietary constituents in the body fluids, that is blood and urine normally, which is useful in evaluating the possibility of malnutrition. Hemoglobin estimation is the most important test and useful index of the overall state of nutrition. Besides anemia, it also tells about protein and trace element nutrition. Stool examination for the presence of ova and intestinal parasites, urine dipstick and microscopy for albumin, sugar and blood, measurement of individual nutrients in the body fluids, example serum retinol, serum iron, urinary iodine, vitamin D, detection of abnormal amount of metabolites in the urine, example, urinary creatinine hydroxyl ratio. Analysis of hair, nails, and skin for micronutrients. Clinical methods. It is an essential feature of all nutritional surveys. It is the simplest and most practical method of ascertaining the nutritional status of a group of individuals and utilizes a number of physical signs that are known to be associated with malnutrition and deficiency of vitamins and micronutrients. Good nutritional history should be obtained. General clinical examinations with special attention to organs like hair, angles of mouth, gums, nails, skin, eyes, tongue, muscles, bones, and thyroid glands. Detection of relevant signs help in establishing the nutritional diagnosis. Dietary evaluation methods. Dietary methods of assessment include looking at past or current intakes of nutrients from food by individuals or a group to determine their nutritional status. You can ask what the family or the mother and the child have eaten over the past 24 hours and use this data to calculate the dietary diversity score. Dietary diversity is a measure of the number of food groups consumed over a reference period, usually 24 hours. Generally, there are 6 food groups that our body needs to have every day. Nutritional intake of humans is assessed by 5 different methods. These are 24-hour dietary recall, food frequency questionnaire, dietary history since early life, food dairy technique, and observed food consumption. Indirect methods. These indirect methods include 3 categories. First is ecological variables, including crop production. Second, economic factors, example, per capita income, population density, and social habits. Third, vital health statistics, morbidity, mortality, and other health indicators, example, infant and under 5 mortality, utilization of maternal and child healthcare services, fertility indices, and sanitary conditions. Ecological variables are agriculture, crop production, irrigation, livestock, etc. These are indirectly involved for individual food consumption but play key role in nutritional status of an individual. Agriculture contributes good crop yield, which can improve consumption patterns of the family. Therefore, nutritional status of that family members show good status. Now we'll talk about the economic factors, including per capita income, population density, and social habits. Economic status, which measured through per capita income, shows financial status of the family. The total number of family members and social status can indicate the consumption patterns. The sociocultural practices, which may include taboos related to food consumption, can reflect their nutritional status. Vital statistics. These are statistical data related to health, morbidity, mortality, and other health indicators, example, infant and under 5 mortality, utilization of maternal and child health care services, fertility indices, and sanitary conditions. The interrelation between health and nutrition can reflect through these indices. Anthropometric indicators. The most used anthropometric indicators are stunting, wasting, underweight, and mid-upper arm circumference in children under 5 years of age and body mass index in adults. Height for age. The term stunting is used to describe a condition in which children fail to gain sufficient height given their age. Stunting is an extremely low height for age score. Stunting is often associated with long-term factors such as chronic malnutrition, especially protein-energy malnutrition, and frequent illness. It is therefore an indicator of past growth failure and is often used for long-term planning of policies and programs in non-emergency situations. Stunting is very sensitive to socioeconomic inequalities. Weight for height. The term wasting refers to a situation where a child has failed to achieve sufficient weight for height. Weight for height is normally used as an indicator of current nutritional status. Wasting may be the consequence of starvation or severe disease. It can also be due to chronic conditions or a combination of both. Weight for age reflects body mass relative to age. Unlike height, Weight fluctuates over time and therefore reflects current and acute as well as chronic malnutrition. Weight for age is commonly used for monitoring growth and to assess change in the magnitude of malnutrition over time. The recommended reporting system of height for age, weight for height, and weight for age is in terms of Z-scores, a statistical measure of the distance from the median expressed as a portion of the standard deviation. The most common cutoff point is 2 Z-score, that is, 2 standard deviations below the median values of the international reference. This is the cutoff risk level used to differentiate malnourished children from those adequately nourished. Children whose height for age, weight for height, and weight for age scores fall below this point are therefore considered stunted, underweight, and wasted respectively. The WHO has proposed a classification scheme for population level malnutrition. Mid upper arm circumference, MUAC. MUAC is a measure of the diameter of the upper arm and gauges both fat reserves and muscle mass. It is primarily used for children but can also be applied to pregnant women to assess nutritional status. Measurement is simple and requires minimal equipment. MUAC has therefore been proposed as an alternative index of nutritional status, particularly in situations where data on height, weight, and age are difficult to collect. BMI, body mass index. BMI is a measure to define overweight and thinness. BMI is defined as the weight in kilos divided by the square of height in meters. The BMI is primarily used to identify chronic energy deficiencies or obesity. BMI is the indicator used to assess adult nutritional status in both stable context and emergencies. It is of particular importance in areas where adults may be as vulnerable to malnutrition as children. WHO has proposed BMI cutoffs for adults. The BMI cutoffs for adults over 20 years, a BMI range of less than 16 says that the person is underweight with grade 3 thinness. BMI between 16 to 16.99 says underweight with grade 2 thinness. BMI between 17 to 18.49 is also underweight with grade 1 thinness. The normal range of BMI is from 18.5 to 24.99. BMI from 25 to 29.99 denotes overweight, this is pre-obesity, and a BMI of more than 30 means obesity. Conceptual framework, nutrition throughout the life cycle model. The nutrition throughout the life cycle model shows the importance of nutrition at every stage of an individual. It starts with the arrival of an individual from mother's womb. The first step in this model starts with a baby's low birth weight. The birth weight of the baby depends upon mother's nutritional health status. The baby in the mother's womb gets its food through placenta from its mother. That means if mother consumes nutritional food, it directly reaches the baby. The birth weight of the child is one nutritional health indicator. Soon after the birth of the newborn, its body weight has to be recorded. This is called birth weight of the newborn child. If any newborn child birth weight is less than 2500 grams, it is called as low birth weight child. The recording of birth weight is compulsory for all newborn children. The consequences of low birth weight on baby will be increased risk of adult chronic disease, higher mortality rate, impaired mental development. The child is vulnerable for all these health hazards. Further, untimely inadequate weaning, frequent infections, and inadequate food and healthcare will result to inadequate catch-up growth. The child will be stunted, which means the height of the child as per age will be less. The child who is stunted will face reduced mental capacity. Adding to this is inadequate food, health and care. Next stage is adolescent stunted. Adolescence is transition period from childhood to adulthood. Adolescence is one of the most rapid phases of human development. Biological maturity precedes psychological maturity. This has implications for policy and program responses to the exploration and experimentation that takes place during adolescence. The characteristics of both the individual and the environment influence the changes taking place during adolescence. Younger adolescents may be particularly vulnerable when their capacities are still developing and they are beginning to move outside their confines of family. The changes in adolescence have health consequences not only in adolescence but also over the course of lifetime. The unique nature and importance of adolescence mandates explicit and specific attention in health policy and programs. In many ways, adolescent development drives the changes in the disease burden between childhood to adulthood. For example, the increase with age in sexual and reproductive health problems, mental illness, and injuries. Many of the health-related behaviors that arise during adolescence have implications for both present and future health and development. During this adolescent period, if inadequate food, health, and care continues, then they grow as adults who are vulnerable to diseases. Next stage is malnourished women who will face adolescent marriage and pregnancy. This malnourished woman will not gain weight during her pregnancy. The result will be inadequate fetal nutrition, reduced capacity to care for baby. The outcome will be again low birth weight baby. If a woman who is malnourished continues with inadequate food, health and care, she'll be elderly malnourished. This model, called as life cycle model, shows the effect of nutrition at every stage of human being. Framework guiding empirical work analysis. The conceptual work of UNICEF shows various factors contributing for child's nutritional status. The model has classified into three sections. They are immediate determinants, underlying determinants, and basic determinants. Immediate determinants. The child's nutritional status will be depending on two immediate determinants called as child's dietary intake and child's health status. The child's dietary intake and child's health status are interrelated. These both factors show immediate effect on child's nutritional status. Therefore, it is called as immediate determinants. Underlying determinants. It has three sectors called as household food security, care for mother, and child and health environment and its services. The household food security depends on resources for food security issues like food production at household level, cash income, which shows economic status of the family, and transfer of food in kind. The household agriculture production and family income can play to increase food consumption by family members. Next is care for mothers and child, which can be linked to child's dietary intake and child's health. This is controlled by the caregiver for the child, that is the mother, and her control of the resources and her autonomy. Caregiver or mother's physical and mental status and also her knowledge and beliefs. This shows complete autonomy and empowerment status of mother at household level and its impact on child's nutrition and health status. The health environment and services, which is related to resources for health. This sector has safe drinking water, supply, adequate sanitation, health care availability, and environmental safety or shelter. The safe drinking water supply at household level contributes prevention of waterborne diseases. If a person is healthy, his or her food consumption will be improved. Adequate sanitation, which is related to toilets and environmental cleanliness. The practice of open defecation causes major health issues. Household toilets and its usage can prevent many communicable diseases and it will make individuals healthy. The present government also started a program called Swachh Bharat Abhiyan in this regard. Healthcare availability is one of the important components of children's nutritional status. The availability, accessibility, and affordability of healthcare services at household level plays important role. The type of healthcare services available for the family should be affordable to the family. The healthcare services accessibility to family is related to other infrastructural facilities such as roads and transportation facilities. The environmental safety and shelter is related to the location or area where the people stay. The family, which is located in a safe environment, can give safe living conditions to the child. These three sectors are controlled by one common factor called poverty. The hunger and poverty are both totally related issues. Poverty impacts every aspect like food availability, women's care, health status, and household condition. Therefore, government has also started poverty eradication programs and income generating programs. Now we'll talk about political and economic structure. These are called as basic determinants. This is related to political structure and governance. The political involvement and their intention for welfare of the people gives healthy society. The political stability, protection and security of nation gives comfort to its citizens. Social environment, this is another basic determinant. The societal factors, social order and social fabrication shows much impact on people. The marginalization, vulnerability, discrimination, all should be avoided to achieve safe society for every citizen. Potential resources, environment, technology and people, these are also known as basic determinants. These can reach all sectors. It is important to effectively utilize the modern technology and available resources for the welfare of people and environment. These all give the best nutritional status of child. Children are the future of a nation, and these factors together contribute towards good nutritional health and status and development of a child. Height for age, denoted by H/A. The term stunting is used to describe a condition in which children fail to gain sufficient height given their age. Stunting is an extremely low height for age score. Stunting is often associated with long-term factors such as chronic malnutrition, especially protein energy malnutrition and frequent illness. It is therefore an indicator of past growth failure and is often used for long-term planning of policies and intervention programs in non-emergency situations. Stunting is very sensitive to socioeconomic inequalities. Weight for height, denoted by W by H. The term wasting refers to a situation where a child has failed to achieve sufficient weight for height. Weight for height is normally used as an indicator of current nutritional status. Wasting may be the consequence of starvation or severe disease. It can also be due to chronic conditions or a combination of both. Weight for age, denoted by W by A. The term underweight is used to describe a situation where a child weighs less than expected given his or her age. Underweight is thus an extremely low weight for age score. Weight for age reflects body mass relative to age. Unlike height, weight fluctuates over time and therefore reflects current and acute as well as chronic malnutrition. Weight for age is commonly used for monitoring growth and to assess changes in the magnitude of malnutrition over time. The recommended reporting system for height for age, weight for height, and weight for age is in terms of Z-scores. A statistical measure of the distance from the median expressed as a proportion of the standard deviation. The most common cutoff point is 2 Z-scores, that is 2 standard deviations below the median value of the international reference. This is the cutoff risk level used to differentiate malnourished children from those adequately nourished. Children whose height for age, weight for height, and weight for age scores fall below this point are therefore considered stunted, underweight, and wasted respectively. The WHO has proposed a classification scheme for population level malnutrition. Mid upper arm circumference, denoted by MUAC. MUAC is a measure of the diameter of the upper arm and gauges both fat reserves and muscle mass. It is primarily used for children but can also be applied to pregnant women to assess nutritional status. Measurement is simple and requires minimal equipment. MUAC has therefore been proposed as an alternative index of nutritional status, particularly in situations where data on height, weight, and age are difficult to collect. Body mass index, BMI. BMI is a measure to define overweight and thinness. BMI is defined as the weight in kilos divided by square of height in meters. The BMI is primarily used to identify chronic energy deficiencies or obesity in adults. BMI is the indicator used to assess adult nutritional status in both stable context and emergencies. It is of particular importance in areas where adults may be as vulnerable to malnutrition as children. WHO has proposed BMI cutoffs for adults. Let us see these cutoffs. For adults over 20 years of age, a BMI range of less than 16 says that the person is underweight, having a grade 3 thinness. A BMI range between 16 to 16.99 suggests that the person is underweight, having grade 2 thinness. A BMI range between 17 to 18.49 suggests the person is underweight with grade 1 thinness. The normal range of BMI is 18.5 to 24.99. A BMI of 25 to 29.99 denotes overweight, and this is the pre-obesity condition. A BMI larger than 30 denotes obesity. Now we'll talk about the conceptual framework, nutrition throughout the life cycle model. The nutrition throughout the life cycle model shows the importance of nutrition at every stage of an individual. It starts with the arrival of an individual from mother's womb. The first step in this model starts with baby's low birth weight. The baby's birth weight depends upon mother's nutritional health status. The baby in the mother's womb gets its food through placenta from its mother. That means if mother consumes nutritional food, it directly reaches the baby. The birth weight of the child is one nutritional health indicator. Soon after the birth, the newborn and its baby weight has to be recorded. This is called birth weight of the newborn child. If the newborn child birth weight is less than 2500 grams, it is called as low birth weight child. The recording of birth weight is compulsory for all newborn children. The consequences of low birth weight on baby will be increased risk of adult chronic diseases, higher mortality rate, impaired mental development. The child is vulnerable for all these health hazards. Further, untimely, inadequate weaning, frequent infections, and inadequate food and health care will result to inadequate catch-up growth. The child will be stunted, which means the height of the child as per age is less. The child who is stunted will face reduced mental capacity. Adding to this is inadequate food, health, and care. Next stage is adolescent stunted. Adolescence is transition period from childhood to adulthood. Adolescence is most important rapid phases of human development. Biological maturity here precedes psychological maturity. This has implications for policy and program responses to the exploration and experimentation that takes place during adolescence. The characteristic of both the individual and the environment influence the changes taking place during adolescence. Younger adolescents may be particularly vulnerable when their capacities are still developing and they are beginning to move outside the confines of their families. The changes in adolescence have health consequences not only in adolescence but all over the life course. The unique nature and importance of adolescence mandates explicit and specific attention in health policy and programs. In many ways, adolescent development drives the changes in the disease burden between childhood to adulthood. For example, the increase with age in sexual and reproductive health problems, mental illness, and injuries. Many of the health-related behaviors that arise during adolescence have implications for both future and present health and nutrition. During this adolescent period, if inadequate food, health, and care continues, then they will grow as adults who are vulnerable to diseases. Next stage is malnourished women who will face adults in marriage and pregnancy. This malnourished woman will not get vein gate during her pregnancy. The results will be inadequate fetal nutrition, reduced capacity to care for the baby by the mother. The outcome will be again low birth weight baby. If a woman who is malnourished continues with inadequate food, health and care, she will be elderly malnourished. This model, called as life cycle model, shows the effect of nutrition at every stage of human being. Now we'll discuss the framework guiding empirical analysis. The conceptual work of UNICEF shows various factors contributing for child's nutritional status. The model has classified into three sections. They are, first, immediate determinants, second, underlying determinants, and the third one, basic determinants. Immediate determinants. The child's nutritional status will be depending on two immediate determinants called as child's dietary intake and child's health status. The child's dietary intake and child's health status are interrelated. These both factors show immediate effect on child's nutritional status. Therefore, it is called as immediate determinants. Underlying determinants. It has three sectors called as household food security, care for mother and child, and health environment and services. The household food security depends on resources for food security issues like food production at household level, cash income, which shows income status of the family, and transfer of food in kinds. The household agriculture production and family income can play to increase food consumption by the family members. Next is care for mother and child, which can be linked to child's dietary intake and child's health. This is controlled by the caregiver for the child, that is the mother's control of resources and autonomy. Caregiver or mother's physical and mental status and also her knowledge and beliefs. This shows complete autonomy and empowerment status of mother at household level and its impact on child's nutritional and health status. The health environment and services, which is related to resources for health. This sector has safe drinking water supply, adequate sanitation, healthcare availability, and environment safety and shelter. The safe drinking water supply at household level contributes in prevention of waterborne diseases. If a person is healthy, his or her food consumption will be improved. Adequate sanitation, which is related to toilets and environmental cleanliness. The practice of open defecation causes major health issues. Household toilets and its usage can prevent many communicable diseases and it will make individuals healthy. The present government has also started a program called Swachh Bharat Abhiyan. Healthcare availability is one of the most important components of child's nutritional status. The availability, accessibility, and affordability of healthcare services at household level play a very important role. The type of healthcare services available for the family should also be affordable to the family. The healthcare services accessibility to family is related to other infrastructural facilities such as roads and transportation facilities. The environmental safety and shelter is related to the location or area where the people stay. The family, which is located in a safe environment, can give safe living conditions to the child. These three sectors are controlled by one common factor known as poverty. Hunger and poverty are both totally related issues. Poverty impacts every aspect of life, such as food availability, women's care, health status, and household conditions. Therefore, government have also started poverty eradication programs and income generating programs. Political and economic structure. These are known as basic determinants. This is related to policy structure and governance. The political involvement and their intention for welfare of the people gives healthy society. The political stability, protection, and security of the nation gives comfort to its citizens. Next comes the social environment. This is another of the basic determinants. The societal factors, social order, and social fabrication show much impact on people. The marginalization, vulnerability, and discrimination all should be avoided to achieve safe society for each and every citizen. Now we'll discuss the potential resources, environment, technology, and people. These all are again known as basic determinants. They reach all the sectors. It is very important to effectively utilize the modern technology and available resources for the welfare of the people and environment. These all give the best nutritional status of a child. Children are the future of the nation, and these factors together contribute towards good nutritional health, status, and development of the child. Thank you.